This is the set for Professor Griffin's Midnight Shadow Show. It's filled with paraphernalia and props and memorabilia from horror films. A little stage, a little podium, some candles. It's much bigger on camera, but coffins, swords, just about anything you can think of, it's here. The environment suits us. The Shadow Show is basically all that you see here is from my house. You know, as sad as that may seem, I grew up in Houston, and when I was there, I used to watch Harold Gunn, who was a local TV personality in Houston. And he hosted Boo Theater every Saturday night, and it was my local horror host that I grew up with. And I'd watch things like, you know, Attack of the Mushroom People or Godzilla vs. Megalon or things like that, and sneak out late at night, turn the sound down. It's a classic story. A lot of people have that memory of a local horror host, and that was mine. After all that was said and done, I went to college and I got my BFA in acting, and I did improv comedy for many, many years and worked off Broadway and did some stuff. I just, you know, I was an actor. I did acting stuff, and then moved here to Austin and basically took the two things I love most, which is acting and monsters, put them together, and the most logical thing to do at this point was to do a show like this. Plus, Austin didn't have one. Late one night when the moon was tall, the midnight monsters had a ball. At the county morgue till the break of day, you could hear those monsters say, hey, goo, hey, goo, you're cool, you're cool. At the midnight monsters rock. Well, it's appealing. There's, you know, because I think a lot of people grew up with that local show, that local horror show. And it's all ages. We don't do anything adult. We don't do anything that can't be shown to a kid, because that was what I grew up with. I didn't want to cross that line. I didn't want them to do anything that was not kid friendly, because kids love monsters. So that's what I wanted to bring that appeal in, and it spoke for itself, and we got a lot of good press. Your basic episode will be always around the movie. If you doing a host show or horror host show or any kind of dinner and a movie, whatever show you're doing, the movie is the basis of it. It's the meat of it. Everything else around it is dressing. Well, our dressing's pretty good. We have good dressing. And, you know, we do little plots and little comedy bits, and there'll be a theme running through the show or something, or Usher and Daniel will get into trouble and Griffin has to get them out, or Griffin comes up with some crazy idea. And you know, the personalities really work on it, and it makes it really enjoyable. When I wrote Usher's character out, I wanted this stoic, almost sardonically bored character that would play off of Griffin's manic energy, because Griffin does have sort of a manic energy from time to time, and Usher is most of the time very low-key and reserved. Dan was not frightening, but just disturbing-looking image. He was supposed to be this character who was found living underneath Griffin Manor in the asylum. He was its last inmate.
I think we're doing a pretty good job, all things considered. I mean, with the boss gone and all, I think we make a pretty good team there, huh?
You know, you're right, we do. We do make a pretty good team. For the show, that is.
Yep, a pretty good team.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, Shamil, Shamazel, Toss and Fat Incorporated.
I could show you the character sketches that I did for Usher and Dan Dan before they were even cast. These sketches that I did of the characters, their costumes, the way they looked. And you could hold them up and go, well, damn, there they are. You know, and it's neat to see them come to life. And that, of course, the dynamic of the show, plus the movie that we're hosting, creates for a lot of fun.
I used to buy and sell cars, restore them. I actually built the car on Office Space and gets the bumper yanked off of. That's how I kind of got into film to begin with. I was like, well, you know, this is kind of cool. Had a lot more technical stuff behind me at that time and didn't really focus too much on the creative stuff as much. So when I met Joseph, it kind of opened my eyes up to, you know, more of the creative side, and, you know, because that's all Joseph is, just pure creative side.
Comedy's easy for me, but taking the comedy and then adding the horrific tones, that black comedy makes it a lot more appealing to me. The show
was picked up by Fangoria TV, which is supposed to be an upcoming all-horror cable channel. And they love the show, and we signed with them, and it's been wonderful. It's a great relationship. But at the same time, we don't want to stop doing it local. We don't want to stop doing what we do, because we have so much fun doing it. Our shoots are just fun. We laugh, we have a great time. And it's become less work and more just playtime. So Shane decided we needed to work more.
Yeah. I'm tired of the banter.
That's right. He was like, you know what? This is not work anymore. It's too much fun. So Shane decided he wanted to make movies. And
damn, Shane.
I know. And we did.
Well, I have a ghost story like no other. Watch your back.
For Ghost Wolf, literally, we had no script. It was in here, we were all like, "It'd be nice if we had something."
What the hell?
Say this, okay? But this next film. The second film that we're working on, it's
definitely
currently in post-production, is I think the strongest in what I know and what he knows. It's the ultimate collaboration.
Right.
It's got some real scary parts. It's got a lot of gory parts in it. It's got some great action. It's got shootouts. It's got horses. It's got a huge Western town. And it's got some fairly memorable monsters that appear early on and stick with you. You know, it's fun. That's we have to make these movies fun.
Welcome to Rosewood. Our homes or your homes?
There will be a few things, a few rules. During the day, no one is to leave town. We will patrol the outer countryside and return at night to stand guard.
We are lepers. We are not contagious. It's just that we don't look so good.
To move on to a second film is a rare thing. Most independent filmmakers make one film. It's kind of like freshmen going to college, 45% wash out the first semester, you know, and those are the laws of averages, you know. So the fact that we've got past one, we already shot two, is refreshing, you know. And unfortunately, because we're in Austin and they think there's only three filmmakers in Austin, these movies kind of go under the radar, you know. Yes, it got sold, but you know, you don't really hear about it, you know. That's all changing, you know, thank goodness. But I mean, there's a lot of people out there trying to do something, you know, and make films and stuff like that. Typical studio. Yeah, you have your prop department, you have your wardrobe department, you have your special effects department.
All our castings, molds, and you'll see a couple of heads sitting out there from The Magnificent Dead.
There's nothing we don't do here. If we need it, we'll build it here. Then you got the editing bay, which is all where the magic comes together, and you have all the audio done as well, your sound booth for any voiceover, guitar work, whatever. Of course, we got drum kits, we've got guitars, you know, whatever you need. I think when it's all going to kind of hit at once, I think when this film's done and hits and we throw it out there and let the audience like it or don't like it or whatever, you know, I think that's our next big push, you know. And then we'll sit back and we're already working on other scripts and, you know, we're always doing something. And those films will even be elevated even more. I think it's a gradual step. You got to prove it and prove to financiers, money makers, any of those guys that you can actually do this stuff. You're not just somebody that can grab a camera and say, I'm going to make this movie. Because those days are kind of going. Nobody wants to gamble, you know, anymore. They said, you know, let's make sure that you really know what you're doing. Let's make sure you've had some type of success before we even talk to you. And that's basically the steps we're going through.
Again, we've been very fortunate in our working relationship and the people we surrounded ourselves with that have helped us and have contributed to things that we've done. We've just been very lucky. It's and that's the key. If there is a key, I would say find people who love this, who love it just as much as you do, and surround yourself with these people, you know. There's a lot of people in this town who'll say, I'm going to do this, and I'm working on this, and I've got my second draft up, and, you know, do it. Absolutely just do it, you know. And it could fall on your face the first time. That's okay. Get up. Do it again.